next question, I would like to ask, which in which you have really done a tremendous work through your book also. So let me read that question. One of the trump cards used by the missionaries as well as other Breaking India forces is that it was the Britishers who had brought social justice to our divided society, which had one section of people so much oppressed that the women in that community were not allowed to wear the upper garment. Okay, so allegedly this kind of oppression was removed by enacting a law, and therefrom justice prevailed. I am referring to this upper cloth revolt. You have looked into the way these Christian missionaries have concocted the original revolt, thereby creating fault lines in Tamil society and exploiting them to their interest. This concoction, their concoction, has been so successful that it has become a pan-Indian lore. I mean, when I talk to some of the North Indian friends, also they even refer to this particular revolt, upper cloth revolt. Can you please throw more light on this upper cloth revolt and how the missionaries had concocted it?
Ramachandran. Certainly. The very term upper cloth revolt was coined by missionaries. It's not a correct term. Actually, to terming it as a revolt, it will be embedded in the psyche of the people. That it, a revolt is a, for example, revolutionary revolt. Such words are used for to propagating a view that this society was always based on injustice. So subaltern groups were revolting to claim their rights as human beings. That is what they wanted to project or picturize. And to say some extent they were successful. Because, for example, even now the term survives, upper cloth revolt. Originally the term should be struggle for this restoration or conservation, preservation of the right of wearing the upper cloth. That should be the correct term. Because from the past itself, these people, especially ladies who were termed as Shanar ladies, the Santor must be the correct term. Nadar is only a surname. It's a caste title, not the name of the caste. So I will, let me use the word Shanar. So it is considered derogatory because they have mentioned the Shanar. Shanar ladies, they were not permitted by the rulers, especially Nayars, who were dominant landholders, who were the administrators, who belonged to the martial race, and who were the rulers of Kerala. They did not permit the downtrodden Shanar ladies to wear the upper cloth. This is total lie. And especially the Christian missionaries, they tried to create this picture that these Shanar ladies were not entitled to wear this upper cloth. It was not so. Originally, the thing, it was a clash of consciousness. The Nadar or Shanar people, they belonged to the Chera dynasty or Chera royal house. After the 12th century, that is around 1114, the last Chairman Perumal, he went as an ascetic. He renounced the world. And before that, he gave his daughter in marriage to Perumbadappu Illam Nambudiri, and with an assurance that their offspring will become the Kshatriya, Kochi Kshatriya. That's this has been recorded by historians. Though it is not an exact truth, it has some major element of truth in that. By this way, the entire Kerala became a Parasurama Kshetra, where Brahmins became the rulers. It may be true. No, I am not denying the fact that the Kerala, after 12th century, it became a Parasurama Kshetra, where Nambudiri's writ ran large. but how and why the original people belonging to the Chera lineage, they migrated to either towards the east, Coimbatore district, that is adjacent to Palghat district, and down south, Kanyakumari district. This Kanyakumari district formed part of this Travancore state up to 1956, only due to reorganization of states on linguistic basis. it was merged. Kanyakumari district was merged into Madras state and later became Tamil Nadu. But before that, it formed part of Travancore state. The Travancore king and all other military people, they were all Nayars. But in the 17th and 18th century, these people, Nadar people, Shanar peoples were at the receiving end. It is true. But at the same time, there were also some Turakara means who were looking after administration, the provinces. There were some Turakara, Nadars, Shanars were also there. But comparatively speaking, Nadars were at the receiving end. They were there was some downward mobility. Nayars were in the upward mobility mode. So gradually, when Britishers entered into the field, around 1780, Tipu threatened invasion of Travancore area. And British East India Company entered into the scene. They assured the king, the chief of Travancore, to assist him. And by to thwart the invasion of Tipu. And in the year 1790s, Tipu invaded Travancore. At the same, his invasion was thwarted. He was defeated. He was sent back to his Srirangapatna. But due to that assistance, they placed one resident to govern the area. He was called Mekale. And he demanded many dues per year, 3,500 star pagodas initially. Then later, he demanded arrears also. And he disbanded the Nayar regiment and placed the Madras regiment there. Gradually, the Nayars people were going down in the social scale. And there was a Protestant missionary activity supported by the Britishers, British administration. And then particularly one resident after Mekale, one John Munro, he completely dismantled the Vritti lands. Vritti lands means that's like endowments. Lands endowed to Brahmins, temples, and other such. The temples were administered by Nayars. So the Nayars who were leaseholders of the lands, they were also affected. And gradually, many Nayars were, due to the disbandment of this regiment, they become, they had no work to do. So in the social scale also, they were going down. And suddenly John Munro, claiming that arrears of due to 18 lakhs of rupees have to be paid as dues from the government, he abolished the endowments, and then he ordered that all tax to be paid as agriculture tax, thirvai, has to be paid in cash, not in kind. So these leaseholders who were looking after their lands, cultivable lands, they have to, after the harvest, they have to sell the product. They sell especially rice, paddy in the market and make it into cash and then convert into cash and then remit the amount. They found it very difficult because they had no experience in trade. And all the traders were Sanars, Nadars. So they thought their pent-up anger was diverted against the Sanars. And previous to this, when Veluthambi Thalavai was Diwan, after him, the post of Diwan was also abolished. But resident became the Diwan also. But during this Veluthambi's revolt against the Britishers, some Nadars, Shanars were also, royal headors were also joined hands with them. But now, the Nadar traders, gradually they were in the society, social scale, they were moving upward. And economical status also they were gaining. From adjoining Tirunelveli and Tuticorin districts, many Nadar traders who grew tobacco, they were involved in trading tobacco. So gradually they encroached the market forces also. So these Nayars, they have to sell the paddy in a reduced price and then remit a higher amount in the treasury as tax. So such things were building up. Simultaneously, religious conversion also was taking place. And in 1 year, the city magistrate, who was one Charles Mead, he converted 3,000 Nadars in a single year. He was a judge, magistrate. So this open connivance with the missionaries, the colonial administration was acting in such a manner. So this pent-up anger of Nair people, it was gradually turning into a rage, and suddenly it erupted as the humiliating the Shanar ladies in public. Some of the Shanar ladies who covered their breast with blouse and then upper cloth. Upper cloth was already worn by all the Shanar ladies. Nair ladies were not accustomed to the habit of wearing upper cloth because they did not consider this as they will wear mundu. And whenever they come across any foreigner or any Muslim like that, they will cover their breast. Otherwise, they won't cover their breast. So these Nadar Shanar people, they will degradingly ask, call them as Mangalanan Ariyada Mandai Sandai Makkal. Because the Nadar, the Nair custom of marriage was not, there was no Mangali Sutra, Thali was not tied around the bride's neck. The bridegroom will give a white colored silk sari to the bride. The bride will accept that the marital ceremony is over. This is called Pudavai Kodai in among Nayars. The marriage is called Pudavai Kodai, simply gift of sari. So they were not accustomed to the adorning their neck with the thali. So this is also, they were pointed out this fact. Mangalanan Ariyada Mandai Sadnai Makkal. These people are herd. They are behaving like a herd, these Nayars. They don't know the auspiciousness of the Thali, Mangali Sutra. So such things both became severe opponents, and both of them were some of the Christian converts, Shanars. They thought that their duty to this government, usually paid in the form of labor, need not be paid now onwards because they have become, they have been liberated from Hinduism and they have joined Christianity. And there was a proclamation also. Nadar converts need not pay the uliyam. Uliyam means tax in the form of labor. They need not do that. There was a proclamation by the resident. So such things went to the boiling point, and it erupted as the humiliation of Shanar ladies by tearing the blouses and humiliating them by removing the upper cloth. So they resisted, and especially one thing we have to, two things we have to notice. One is Ayya Vaikundar, who was a reformist among Shanar community people. He clearly says that Pottirunda Thol Silai Podade Endru Sonnan. That is, the Nayars or the rulers, they warned the Shanar people, don't use your traditional dressing mode. Pottirunda Thol Silai Podade Endru Sonnan. Now onwards, you have no right to cover your breasts. So it is clearly mentioned in all such literary references that Shanar people were accustomed to wearing this upper cloth. It was their usual mode of dress. Nair ladies had did not pretend to be very particular about this type of dress. They were not particular that to cover their breasts among themselves. Whenever a foreigner or a Muslim or such people, they have to come across, they will cover their breast. So this is the clash of consciousness, and it erupted in such a manner. And there is another reference. It was a very particular reference. In the year 1859, the resident, with the advice of the resident, the king proclaimed, he issued a proclamation that hereafter, Shanar ladies can wear the upper cloth. They should not be molested. Prior to that, on the day of 7th February 1859, the resident was one Mr. Lieutenant Colonel Cullen. 6 London missionaries have submitted a petition to him. In that petition, 8th point is very significant. They have openly accepted that the system of upper cloth did not find its origin among the Protestant missionary. It was going on for centuries. It was the original practice, but that not a Shanar ladies of all subsects or all social status they were wearing this upper cloth as a traditional mode of dressing. We did not entertain into that. We have no connection with that manner, with that particular matter. All Shanar ladies were, before the advent of introduction of Protestant, wearing this. So it does not find its origin among the Protestants or missionaries. That is what they have particularly mentioned in the 8th point in that petition. So it is clear that it was not an upper cloth revolt. It was a struggle for the preserving the rights of the wearing the upper cloth. That's all. It was a clash of consciousness, and there were many points, many economical, socio-economical problems, pent-up anger against which could not be directed against the government because they had the fear that it will be, the punishment will be very severe. So their anger was directed towards the weaker section of the weaker sex ladies, particularly Sonar ladies. That is the main point we want to not only insist, we want to clearly prove that it was not an upper cloth revolt. Missionaries played a very subtle and major role in instigating the clashes with the connivance of the resident. And what they gained means many of the Sonar people, they converted to Christianity. That was their main aim, and particularly why they chose Sonar people, you know, they understood, because they were they had such an administrative talent that Sonar people will be not only obedient, they will grasp any subject, and they behave in an organized and disciplined manner. They were not, they understood that they were not downtrodden for centuries. They were not slaves. They understood that these are the soft targets to convert. That's why they created this problem and propagated like as it is a really upper cloth revolt. That was the agenda of the Protestant Lutheran missionaries. And one thing we have to, this London Mission Society was very notorious. This London Mission Society was there. All the six missionaries belonged to the London Mission Society. The Charles Mead, he was a magistrate. He was a member of the London Mission Society. And this London Mission Society was very active in slave trade in South Africa. After slavery was abolished in 1845, you know, the London Mission Society, they transported many people as indentured laborers. Even Mahatma Gandhi, you know, in Transvaal and Natal, he fought in the legal field also. He fought against the terming these indentured laborers as not belonging to a family, because only when the marriage is baptized, that is marriage is solemnized in the church, it will be considered as a family, or an inheritance will be allowed. Otherwise, a son or daughter born, a child born to this couple, he will also become an indentured laborer. So this injustice, Gandhi was particular about opposing it through organizing protests. And you know, Thillai Adivalliyammai and Nagappan, they are all involved in that protest march, and they were herded into a prison, and in the unhygienic conditions, Thillai Adivalliyammai, and they died, pathetically died. So, you know, this London Mission Society was very active in the slave trade. Even after slavery was abolished, this same London Mission Society, who preached that they were concerned about all such downtrodden people, they were concerned about social justice, everything. They blabbered like anything, but they were the main culprits in indulging in slave trade. After the abolition of slave trade, they were the exporters of indentured laborers to South Africa. That we have to understand.